All right, welcome back everyone to yet another daily video. And in today's video, I want to cover a topic that is quite recurring for a lot of investors out there, and that is the stock-based compensation. A lot of people shy away from Palantir when they see the amount of dilution that Palantir is issuing. But in today's video, I want to put some clarity on that and explain why it looks the way it does and what Palantir gets in return for it. And more importantly, how it stacks up against other businesses within the SaaS space. So that's what we will be covering today. However, we are dropping one video per day throughout the whole of July. So please like and subscribe if you have not already. So today's update on Palantir, basically flat, trading around that 140 mark, still relatively expensive and overvalued to me. However, if you watched the video from a few days ago, Palantir is actually fairly valued if you include business specific risk. So I don't think the market is giving a premium to Palantir necessarily in terms of value. But have a look at that video for more details. In today's video, we're going to jump to the charts tab here. So we have the stock-based compensation chart here. And for a lot of people, this is a big issue and why a lot of people shy away from investing in Palantir. So if we see here in 2020, 116% SBC as a percentage of revenue, that's what we're looking at mainly here. So we have the bars, which are the total stock-based compensation in terms of million. And then we have this dashed line here, which represents the SBC as a percentage of revenue. So that's basically a way to measure how much are they diluting relative to how much revenue they're getting. And by doing that, we can also compare to different companies using the same basis. So as of 2024, 24% SBC as a percentage of revenues, but keep in mind that they had this Q4, which is really an outlier. So excluding that, it's more or less, if we normalize this period, it would have been roughly 20% SBC as a percentage of revenue. And as of Q1 of 2025, that has dropped even further to 18%. Now, I want everyone watching this video to keep this 18% in mind, because that will be important. As well as you see, there's a clear downtrend over time. They are growing their revenues a lot faster than they are diluting. So that will mean that over time, this figure here, SBC as a percentage of revenue, will keep decreasing. Now, the question then becomes, what do they get in return for all of this stock-based compensation? Well, one way to look at it is to look at employee efficiency. And we can do that by looking at revenue per employee. But before I go to that chart, I just want to mention that a lot of credible sources online, and even before Palantir was public, like even if you go back 10, 15 years, Palantir has been a highly sought after company to work for. And it has been notoriously difficult to get a job at Palantir. Basically, they only hire brilliant people, the best of the best. And that has been the case for a very, very long time. And people who have been going to the best schools have been discussing on interviewing for Palantir. Like if you go back 10 years in time and you look at some Reddit posts, there's been a lot of discussion at trying to score a job at Palantir and how attractive it is. And that, I believe, still persists today, because if we look at revenue per employee, basically measuring employee efficiency, it has really been up and to the right, like a very, very positive trend here. But the issue with this metric is that in isolation, this does not tell us a lot. We don't know if $780,000 per employee is a lot for a quarter. Or if we look annually, we don't know if $728,000 for fiscal year 2024 is a lot or not. Now keep in mind, this is using trailing 12 months revenue. So that's why the yearly and the quarterlies are similar, because it basically uses the last four quarters, trailing 12 months here. But yeah, 779 up from 728, up from 680. So it's really trending positively, but as I mentioned, in isolation, we don't really know if this is impressive or not. So what I have done for today's video, I have compiled two charts here. The first one being stock-based compensation as a percentage of revenue. And I included some of the most common SaaS names. I'm sure I missed out on many. You can, of course, go and do this experiment yourself if you're curious how Palantir stacks up against another particular company. But we have in this particular experiment, we have Adobe, Salesforce, Palo Alto Networks, ServiceNow, The Trade Desk, Cloudflare, Datadog, CrowdStrike, Palantir, Snowflake, and C3AI. Now, as we can see, the more mature companies that have been around for a longer time tend to be diluting a lot less as a percentage of revenues. And in this specific chart, Adobe at 8%, Salesforce 8%. So those are basically your more mature SaaS companies. Then we have Palo Alto Networks with quite a jump to 14%. We have ServiceNow at 16, Trade Desk 20, Cloudflare 21, Datadog 21, CrowdStrike 23, and that's when we have Palantir also at 23% on a trailing 12-month basis. And then we have Snowflake and C3AI. Now this looks like, yeah, Palantir is in the back, but it's not quite as horrible as it appears to be, because while it is towards the back here in this list, it is still 23%. I mean, we're talking a few percentage points of being right up into the middle. And then we have the two outliers here, Snowflake and C3AI, with more or less extreme dilution. C3AI at more or less 60% of the revenues just is in right back in as stock-based compensation. So that's, of course, very unattractive. And so I would say Snowflake. They've been around for long enough that 40% is kind of rough. And I believe most of that is in sales and marketing. However, if we go back to the stock-based compensation chart and we look at the quarterly here, as you can see, when we look at this 23% here, this is on a trailing 12-month basis. And then we have this specific quarter of Q4 where they had a big recognition in SARS, a SARS SPC expense that drove this specific quarter to 34%. So that's why you see this big, big jump. But if you normalize that quarter, excluding SARS, you basically have 20% for the year, and 20% would score Palantir below the middle point here, basically more or less a SmackDown average. Now, if you look at the latest quarter, 18%, that would have put Palantir like in the top five least dilutive SaaS companies out of this list, like less than Cloudflare, CrowdStrike, Trade Desk, Datadog, and so forth. Just behind ServiceNow and Palo Alto Networks. So Palantir is not an outlier. They're not diluting extremely more than other companies in the SaaS space, excluding these very, very mature ones like Adobe and Salesforce. They're actually, as of right now, average or even below, better than average if you look at just the latest quarter here at 18%. But I don't cherry pick the data. Q4 had a SARS expense. It drives up the average. So that's what we're using. We're not going to cherry pick or normalize that period just to make Palantir look better. But they are basically average. So they're not diluting a lot relative to other SaaS businesses. Of course, if you go to other industries, that 20% is a lot if you compare it to something like like a fintech or something, like even something like S&P Global or something like that. It looks horrible, all of these SaaS companies. But yeah, now the important part that a lot of people glance over is, okay, Palantir, they do have basically average SPC within the SaaS space, but what are they getting in return? Remember that discussion about having some of the best engineering talent in the world. Well, how does that translate? Well, Keep in mind, Palantir in this chart is basically average or towards the back. But if we look at revenue per employee, Palantir is number one. And they have been number one for every quarter that I have tracked this, using more companies than charted here. Every time I look at this, Palantir is always number one within the SaaS space. And suddenly, that average kind of SBC as a percentage of revenues at 20%, well, they're getting a lot out of each and every employee if you average it out. And keep in mind, this is also on a trailing 12-month basis. Now, let's see how this stacks up. Let's see C3 AI here. They are the least efficient per employee, but funny enough, they are the highest dilutive company. Now, that should be kind of a warning sign. Basically, if you're diluting a lot, you want to be getting out a lot of those employees as well. That is not the case for C3 AI. Snowflake, 40%, but kind of average here in revenue per employee, meaning that they're also not really getting a lot of bang for their buck. Like, they are compensating the employees, but the employees are not really delivering on the efficiency there. Like, is it really worth to dilute to that degree when you're not really getting much out of it? But yeah, Palantir, above and beyond the rest, basically up there with Adobe. Also, the Trade Desk is very impressive in revenue per employee. But yeah, Palantir, they are diluting shares. There is no way around it, but that should already be reflected in your valuation models. You should be diluting every period in your forecast in your intrinsic valuation model. Now, if you have downloaded mine that are available on my Substack here under intrinsic valuations, I do that for every valuation. I always dilute the period. So the valuation model already reflects dilution from SBC. Sorry, maybe my camera was blocking the names here. So basically Palantir and then Adobe here right next to each other, but Palantir as number one. Now, I don't think a lot of investors take notice of that. They just see 23%. Maybe they're used in investing in something like Microsoft or something, or Apple, and they look at Palantir's 23% and they don't realize that it's basically industry average, or even better than industry average if you look at the most recent quarter, which I suspect will be even less the next quarter. So by the time we get rid of this 34%, Palantir's SPC will look a lot more attractive to a bigger and wider investor base that really gets hung up on this dilution rate as of right now. But then if you take into account that they are also the most efficient SaaS company in terms of revenue per employee, it starts to make a lot more sense. So this Excel sheet with the charting tool, all the 1,000 rows of data, basically every data point about Palantir, the dashboard, all of that is available on typefcapital.com. And if you're interested in the Substack, I just posted today, just now before recording this video, a new portfolio update and track my personal portfolio as well as equity research. That is available at research.typefcapital.com. So they are different. typefcapital.com for the website with the financial models, and then research.typefcapital for the Substack. So with that said, please like and subscribe, and see you guys tomorrow for tomorrow's video. Bye bye, everyone.